Time now for Morning Rounds with CBS News Chief Medical Correspondent Dr. John LaPook and CBS News Contributor Dr. Holly Phillips. First up, this week President Obama announced new plans to help combat the abuse of prescription opioids and heroin. This deadly epidemic is reaching all corners and demographics of the country, including pregnant women. Here's John on a program that's helping to save lives.
I started on opiates, like pain pills, and then by 19, I was like a full-blown heroin addict.
What was that like?
It was just terrible. Like, I didn't take care of myself. I didn't take care of my kids. Like, I lost custody of both of them.
25-year-old Chelsea Blackburn was still using heroin last June when she found out she was pregnant again.
Does this boy have a name?
She decided to get help from the McGee Women's Hospital of University of Pittsburgh Medical Center, which started the Pregnancy Recovery Center in 2014. The hospital had been inundated with pregnant heroin addicts, 350 in 2012 alone. Program director Dr. Dennis English.
What we were seeing was an ever-increasing number of patients who were addicted to opioids coming here to deliver. And we saw these numbers increasing every year.
It's an outpatient program, and women are gradually tapered off heroin with a drug called buprenorphine. It satisfies the craving for opioids without causing a high. Women take the drug at home and are required to get drug tested every 2 weeks.
Having any cravings?
No.
They also receive counseling and medical care throughout their pregnancy.
36 beautiful centimeters.
So far, more than 130 women have been admitted to the program.
Yay!
And 60% have made it through. 27-year-old Lindsay Duggan completed the program in 2014 while pregnant with twins and remains clean.
You're proud of yourself, but you're also hesitant because you got to stay on top of it. You don't want to get too confident because that's when it creeps back in. I mean, every day it's just a tango with addiction, trying to keep wraps of it.
John, how effective is this program?
It's very effective. When pregnant women take opiates, up to 80% of the babies are born addicted and have some sort of withdrawal symptoms. With this program, with the buprenorphine in that program, 2/3 of the babies are born fine, no withdrawal symptoms.
You've done so many stories. This one shocked me the most. I have to say, it's just a topic I don't think most people are even aware of.
Yeah, it takes your breath away. And people have to realize this is a medical disease. You can't just snap out of addiction. You need treatment.
Well, in a related story, the growing drug abuse epidemic is one reason for a new state law now in effect here in New York. This week, it became the first in the country to mandate and enforce a law requiring doctors to issue electronic prescriptions or face stiff penalties. So how does this affect you guys?
Very directly, it affects actually every healthcare provider in New York. So really, this is the second half of a law that was passed back in 2012. It's called the Internet System for Tracking Overprescribing Act, or iStop. And with the first half of the law, doctors and providers were able to look up a patient's records online to see if they had been prescribed controlled substances by other providers recently. And it worked. It actually cut down on the total number of opiate prescriptions that were written. It cut down on doctor shopping, where patients get the same prescription from two different doctors. And it also alerted doctors to who might be prescribing or abusing medications. The new part of the law actually just went into effect a few days ago, and it gets rid of the prescription pad altogether. This is a very dramatic change. So now all prescriptions, whether they're for controlled substances like Vicodin or Percocet, or non-controlled substances like heart medicines or antibiotics, all prescriptions go straight to the pharmacy via computer electronically. There's no more calling in prescriptions, and there's no more using the prescription pad. Doctors who don't comply are actually subjected to penalties.
Wow.
It could be fines, it could be loss of licensure, or even jail time.
So theoretically, is this supposed to prevent drug abuse, John? And what are the other benefits of it?
Well, the hope is that that would happen, Holly pointed out, the doctor shopping. So a person could come in and say, I've never gotten a prescription, I have pain, can you write it for me? Well, you go on the database and you say, well, wait a second, you just went to three other doctors. So that, of course, there are ways to game the system. But also it helps with handwriting. I mean, there are doctors don't have the best handwriting. And, you know, it's not really a joke because some drugs sound alike and look alike. So quinine and quinidine, totally different medications, and pharmacists could look at some prescription that's not well written and give the wrong medication.
But do your patients like this, or do they hate it? Because, I mean, it forces them to be electronically involved.
Right, right, sure. You know, overall, I think patients like it. I don't find it to be particularly time effective, but, you know, we'll get over that. You know, for me, it's much easier to just get on the phone, call the pharmacist, you get a recording line, you leave the information, and it's done. It's still a learning curve for me to kind of log on and find the pharmacy and do it. But I do think once that's over, it's going to be a benefit for all of us.
I'm on the other side. Okay, I do think it's a little clunky to do the narcotic checking because you have to be out of, in two systems at once, and hopefully that'll improve. But I love the electronic prescribing. I can be in a car. I was in an airplane and got an email from a patient electronically prescribed something to a pharmacy in another state. And of course, there's always a resistance to any kind of change. I'm sure the first doctor many years ago, who was complaining about going from chiseling in the rock, that prescription, to the paper, this silly paper thing. But of course, people don't like to change. I think eventually it's going to be great.
All right, finally, a new Cornell study suggests that depending on our heritage, eating green could be in our genes. The researchers say a genetic variation has evolved in populations that have historically favored vegetarian diets. These include places in India, Africa, and parts of East Asia. The study's authors say this finding could be used to tailor a person's diet to their genome.
That's very interesting.
Well, there's a new term, an emerging field called nutrigenomics. And it's looking at the relationship between nutrition and your genetics.
Right.
So we already know that people with certain genetic conditions, for example, celiac or lactose intolerance, they have trouble with certain foods. Mm-hmm. But now you can look at it even more subtly and say, well, are there certain foods that are better for you because of your genetic profile? It's really interesting. I can imagine in the future we're going to have the future menu. It's going to have the name of the dish, the price, and the genetic profile that it's good for, the genetic profile that it's bad for, but it's really fascinating, and it's just beginning. You heard it here first, or maybe you didn't. Nutrigenomics.
And you'll have that menu on an iPhone, too.
Yeah,
right? Dr. John LaPook and Holly Phillips, thank you both so much.